So anyway, my name's Craig Jones, and like Kirsty's just said about OneKind, I think OneKind do absolutely fantastic work. And I knew Bob, who's the boss, some years ago, and I just like his message. And I think all the team do fantastic work. I travel to Scotland some, once a year, try to when we're not in lockdown. So this is the reason I wanted to help OneKind, as you know, I donate images. I just think they do great work. So my presentation today is four key elements, and what that means is wildlife photography, I found when I was starting out, was an absolute minefield. Over a decade ago, I turned my hobby into a profession, and I emailed some professional wildlife photographers that are still around today, just asking for some help. Would you mentor me, etc., etc.? Nobody ever got back to me, and what that did, that set me on a course to learn about photography. I knew about wildlife with respect, and I knew, you know, what was taught from a child. I didn't really know how to work a camera, so I just learned myself. And I'm just going to go on to these four key elements of just how I work. They sort of very regimented, a little bit boring, but if you sort of got a pen and paper and make notes of these, when you go somewhere, you can apply these four key elements to make your pictures better, to improve your own photography and your own contact. But I just wanted to start with this opening slide, which for me is my own words, and it just means it's very important. And it's wildlife photographers are often afforded the most trust by nature, because often we're the first into their world. How we manage that first contact is so important. Respect, ethics, integrity, and a transparency to our work has never been so important. Inform and inspire the public. Show them the beauty of the natural world. Lead by example by looking after what is around us and entrusted into our care. That means so much to me. And after this presentation, it might make more of a sense, rather than sounding a little bit far-fetched, but it means quite a lot. So I also believe what drives people, if people can tap into that and they understand where it starts, the individual then can look at themselves and wonder what motivates, and can see what motivates them. So it can be in different industries, it can be in your private life, it can be in whatever. If people are able to see the backstory or a little bit more information about the individual, they sort of get an understanding of what their message is. So this, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about my background and how I got into this. So I'm the third of four children. I was brought up in Staffordshire by my mother and father. My mother was an amazing lady. I didn't really have a great bond with my father. So when I was growing up, you'll see here, that's me at the age of 12. I built a bird aviary. There's a couple of birds on the wires there. I used to breed zebra finches. I used to sit in that shed and just study them. My mum allowed me this. It was fantastic. This book over here is the first book that I had when I was eight. In the 80s, there wasn't many magazines with pictures and photography, so it was seemed to be all drawings. And this is from the beloved Woolworths, which is unfortunately closed many years ago. So I used to look at the pictures, and on the front is a tiger, to the side you can't really see as orangutan, and I'll get into, you know, I help those species now. The top right there, the Young Ornithologist Club, I had a little gold kestrel badge and magazine, and I was just really interested, and my mum let me, you know, join this. Today it's called the RSPB Explorers, I think. So this was fantastic. I had this badge and a little metal badge, and that was sewn onto my coat. So this is where I started to learn with the bird aviary. I learned about Darwin's finches and how the different beaks changed. I don't know if any of you have seen that with the Galapagos. There's several species of finches that live on there, and Darwin studied the beaks, how they changed, how they sort of differed for the food variations. So it was very, very clever. If I'm sounding clever, I'm not. I'm uneducated. I've never been to school. Everything I've learned is just through passion and just through learning and drawing. So that's a little bit of my first inclination of wildlife. It's 16, one of the only countries in the Western world that still allows you to join. I joined the army as a soldier. I'm there looking terrified. That's me on active service in a different combat zone. So I joined the army at 16, and I used to, and I served 8 years in different scenarios. I was a sniper. I was I did lots of things at a high level, but I used to use nature to keep me alive. Bird song, calls, the smell on operations, being a sniper, you dug in and watching something on a border for sort of up to 2 weeks, and the rooks, the robins, the bird life were telling me what was around when I couldn't see, almost like a drone. I know this sounds very far-fetched, but I wrote an article about this, and it was almost like nature was my eyes and ears, keeping me alive, me and my spotter, because if we were compromised, you can imagine what happened. But because we're lying on the ground, rooks, birds of prey, lots of other things used to keep me alive. So from a very, very young age, I always used nature to help me, to keep me alive, to learn me. So I'm going to go through these very four key elements. This is how I work as a professional. I use the word professional very loosely, because when you're professional, you've got no money. So if any of you do this as a hobby and you've got a job running alongside it, keep it that way. Now, joking aside, I'm very proud of what I do, but professional, everything goes, all my money goes into what I do. But I think we like labels. But for me, anybody's capable of taking a good shot. So professional is just a term. I promise you, I work with these four key elements. So wherever I go, these four key elements are always sort of working, sometimes subconsciously, sometimes consciously. So these are what I work with: Fieldcraft, which I'm going to touch on more so later, composition, which is massive. Good composition is so easy to achieve once you understand giving the subject a bit of space to look into, which I'll show you some examples of them in. Light is, you know, it's the key to photography. Many of you, if you're interested in photography, you'll understand light really is key. For the first couple of hours of the morning and the last couple of hours at night, that light is softer, it's nice, nature's up. And the last one is settings. We obsess over camera makes, lenses. You've got an expensive this, what settings? But I simplify the settings very easily. So that's just the fourth setting. So I'm just going to break these down, but I'm going to spend a bit more time with Fieldcraft at the end. The first one is Fieldcraft. I put a Scottish mountaineer in here, right up in the Cairngorms, right on the plateau, tiptoeing along this. So composition is key. And for me, in layman's terms, it just means giving the subject a little bit of space in the front so the subject's looking in. So that can be anything. Again, I'll show you a few more examples. There is a technical rule of thirds. If you want to Google that, it's come from the Greek mythology. So it's sort of two vertical lines and four horizontals, and there's four intersections. If you're dyslexic like me and not really educated like that, that sounds really over the top and sort of overbearing. So for me, how I've learned myself and how I help my clients is just create some space, and so the subject's looking in. And how you do that is just simply move your camera. And most people put the subject in the middle. I did that when I first started. So just by making a simple little adjustment in the viewfinder, which you'll see a couple of examples in a minute. Don't be bowled over by the picture looking great in that. This was just an example. Short-eared owl, wild short-eared owl, only work with wild animals, unless it's some of my conservation work that I do. So this owl, lots flying into the frame. The shots before and after were no good. This is just the one shot that obviously works, and that's just creating a bit of space. It's almost on that rule of thirds, which is a bit fancy, but which is that Greek mythology, the rule of thirds. I just simply always try to give the subject space, moving into the space. If you always remember that, composition can make or break an image. It's so important. But then sometimes you can have a bit of a laugh with composition. And when I'm photographing wildlife, I'm not serious, obsessing. I'm not, you know, some photographers say I'm going out with a certain photograph in mind. I don't believe in any of that nonsense. Nature's wild, it's free, and you have to be able to adapt and change with nature. Nature comes first. So yeah, there are some instances where I could have a picture in my brain, but it very rarely plays out. So I've put this in because it's fun. Puffins are funny and beautiful birds. And this is just one just dropping in with to the disgust of the other ones, excuse me, where you're going. So composition can be a little bit funny, but I've still created that little bit of dead space there. But this is a little bit of luck. Puffins make terrible noise, like moaning. And in flight, they're really sort of flappy. So I just heard something coming over my head, almost like a, you know, like a plastic bag flying over it. And it was a puffin landing. So I just put this in just to make you laugh and just also to sort of say, composition can also include funniness. The second key element that I spoke about was light, and light really is sort of so imperative for any photography, should we say. You know, if you're a wedding photographer, children photography, use flash to create that light. In nature, I don't use flash. I don't change anything. This is a barn owl hunting over a marsh area. There's some bulrushes there. And you can create this by underexposing in camera. So it's a very easy thing to do. You just literally use the minus and plus button and you underexpose. You can see on the owl's primary feather, if you sort of calculate it, this sounds a little bit nerdy, you can see the sun is sort of overy and very low in the sky. You can tell that because the sun is just creating that light on its feathers. And this was just what, I love barn owls. I help the Barn Owl Trust. I help a lot of things with barn owls. I love them. I've loved them since I was a child. So this was a beautiful shot, but it just sort of symbolizes light for me. The light's coming through the wing. I've created that composition. So already we've passed composition as a key element, but naturally, as soon as you get used to composing an image, I promise you, you'll do it subconsciously. So here, composition's already applied. So that's a subconscious decision that I've made. The light's beautiful. This is the last couple of hours of light in the day, in the evening, and the first couple of hours and light in the morning are the best times. Nature's also the most busiest, calling, feeding, you know, mating, holding on to its territory. So that first couple of hours from dawn and those last couple of hours of every single day throughout the seasons, all the year, nature is at its most busiest, most vocal, hunting. And then obviously you've got the nighttime wildlife changes over to the nocturnal. So this is just an example of using light. Like I said, composition, subconsciously I've already covered that in this picture, underexpose, which I'll go into on the settings. And then I just press the shutter and watch the owl. It's magic. It's magic when you see one of these birds. So this is the morning light. This is a wild red deer in the Peak District. There's a herd of about 250 that still roam free. These are not park deer. I tend to shy away from the park deer. I've been to Scotland and you've got them there and the mole, they're very sort of nervous. But this is in the Peak District. Again, you can show how you can use light. Cold mornings. Often when I'm going out with photography, I'll check the air pressure. I'll check what the weather's in store. Again, that could sound like a bit of a nerd, should we say, or analysis, but by checking the air pressure, by checking the temperature, you'll know if you're going to get some cold air. So when mammals breathing out, you get there. But composition, again, I've ticked that box subconsciously. As soon as you understand composition, I promise you, you'll start to compose your pictures different. This could be a child looking at its mother. This could be your dog looking out of shot. But just create that space. Just get the subject looking in. So subconsciously, like I keep saying that because once you get used to one of those key elements, which is the composition, you'll do it without even thinking. You'll rely on this light because you'll be hopefully working in the first hour, couple of hours of light, or the last couple of hours in the evening. So the light, the warmth, the temperature will give you this look. You just need then a sort of, hopefully a wild animal sort of appearing like this. So you'll see the strong elements of composition, hopefully. And I know I keep saying that, but it's just about giving space, settings. This is a young child in the Himalayas. They make these snow leopards here out of yak hair. He lives right up 4,600 meters snow leopards. We sheltered in this homestay. This is a young boy. His father was helping me. And on the back of the camera, I was showing him some of the wildlife, and he'd never seen what lives around him. So I thought that was quite a nice picture, but it's not so much to do with settings. It's just hopefully make you laugh. So if you want to make a note of this, this is how I work. This is how I take all my pictures. There's no professional settings. There's no secrets. There's no magazines don't break it down like this. Professionals won't speak in this language. Courses, universities won't put it all on one page like this. There is other stuff that you need to sort of change and adhere to. But if you keep things very, 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 very simple in camera, work with these four key elements with an ethical mindset, your photography will improve, your pictures will improve, your general well-being and how you see those pictures will improve. And then if you post them or you sell them or you want to improve with them, you'll be proud, and every picture you'll take will have a story behind. So I use aperture priority, which is AV on a Nikon, or it's A on a Canon, or it'll be listed as A or AV on all the other makes. There's a dial on top of your camera, and it's a little wheel that you turn around from auto to program, blah, blah, blah. So that's how you get to AV. AV, or aperture priority, controls how much of the subject is in focus. And then by doing that, you can get that diffused background and behind the subject. So like it says underneath, this controls the depth of field, which sounds really nerdy in layman's terms. It just means how much of the subject, as it says thereafter, is in focus through the apertures you choose. These are the four apertures that I predominantly use. F4 is only available for prime lens. Took me 6 years to buy my prime lens on credit cards, so that's wide open. F5.6 is predominantly my most favored one. If there's any photographers watching and you've got like a Tamron lens or a Sigma lens or a cheaper lens, not to diminish it, but you'll only be able to dial in f6.3. so in poor light, f4, 5.6, or your 6.3. Birds in flight is often a question I used to get asked, or a big subject, i.e. a bear or a tiger or something. So I use F8. So that's the next setting. And then F11 is wide angle. You'll see some of the wide angle pictures in the presentation that I've got at the end. And literally, I know this sounds really, really simple. I've never, ever learned from a book. I'm dyslexic. I left school at 16 uneducated. I don't say that to be a smarty pants. I say that to give people hope that they can cut through the myriad and the minefield of photography, the snobbery and the protectionism that I found that no one ever got back to me, that set me on this path that I am today. And that is, I work with wide open apertures like that, which is f4 5 6. I use the camera and aperture priority. I strict on composition. I'm always looking for the light, and settings are just the last little bit there. So along with those settings, there's something called ISO. As some of you can remember, ASA, the old film cameras. So these are the settings that I use. Again, I keep things very, 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 very simple. So I always start at 1,000, and then 10 wouldn't go up to 4,000. But if you've got a camera, you'll know when you start to turn that ISO up, or some of you are on auto ISO, you will get pixelation or a degradation of quality. God, that's a big fancy word, degradation of quality. I like that word, which just means you'll get some clarity and quality dropping off. So I don't really go as high as 4,000. I normally sort of 1,000 to 2,000. So that's in poor light. We've had poor light here in England for weeks, that grey, dank, horrible light. In sunny conditions or bright light, say in India or Africa, or you're traveling, 400 to 800. what ISO does, it's letting light into the camera's iris or settings. You've chosen the apertures previous, which are wide open, and then that will give you the shutter speed. The camera will give you the shutter speed, and it works that out for you. So that's one responsibility that it takes from you by working an aperture priority. I know it sounds very technical, but if you just work an aperture priority, you're changing your apertures, like I've just shown, in your ISO, you then hand responsibility over to your camera to give you the correct shutter speed, which can change depending on light and ISO. So I know that sounds very, very confusing, but if you read camera manuals or you do a two-year course or all that, I promise you it won't be broken down as easy as that and told to you in Northern slang. That's literally how I work. So I work very simply like that, because in the theatre of wildlife, first and foremost, I'm a visitor and I want to work alongside nature, and I don't want to disturb nature. So my settings, the composition, if I get them right, I don't always have to keep thinking about that, if that makes sense. So the composition, right, yeah, looking straight into the frame. Whereas the squirrel's looking straight at me, but I've still created that space there. So if something's looking at you, you can either put them in the center or off. Composition is just, you can put your personal style on that. This is my personal style. I like dead space. I think it creates an interest from the public. So just very, very quickly reiterating before I start on Fieldcraft, composition, light, and settings. The settings are dependent on the weather and your natural light. Composition, you'll get used to, you know, giving some space to the subject. And then the light changes as you know, on the conditions that you're in. But Fieldcraft for me is very, very important. And I wanted to put my background in, not to put anybody off. And you don't have to be an ex-soldier or a sniper or working at that level to apply any of these. I'm trying to empower and inspire people to think that anybody can take photography, because I email professionals, no answer, and I set about working with that mindset you've just seen: aperture priority, composition, light. But shape, shine, and silhouette, key elements to Fieldcraft that I carried over from my days as a soldier, and they work. So I use those in my photography. It's not a secret, it's not a little trick. It actually works, because the shape of something, the shine and the silhouette, which I'm going to go on to, can really make the difference of when you're approaching wild animals or working with wild animals. And I'm going to go through those. So this is the fourth key element, which is Fieldcraft. But then that Fieldcraft is broken down into shape, shine, and silhouette, which I'm going to go into now very, very simply, hopefully that you can understand. I'm not very photogenic, as you can see. I'm often covered up, very rarely in front of the camera, and often wearing hats. But I wanted to show you this two examples, shine. I thought, what can I use for shine? I'll use my bald head. So on the left, this wasn't posed, this was natural. I was just coming out of somewhere and a friend took a picture, and he's a good friend of mine, but he knows that I don't like pictures of myself. It's just, I don't think many photographers like pictures of themselves. There's nothing wrong with me. I don't lack in confidence, nothing like that. I just don't like pictures of myself. I think, you know, it's kind of funny. So anyway, the one on the left shows my bald head, shows the shine. So how do we get rid of shine there and shine there? Just put a hat on. I know that sounds really sort of condescending. I'm not trying to be. Just cover up those elements. Yeah, I've got a little letterbox there with my eyes, but not many wildlife would see that. Some penguins there, this is in the Falklands. So this is the first one of those elements to do with Fieldcraft that we talk about, and that is shine. So after we've laughed at that, that's shine, no shine. So just be aware that when you enter the theatre or the countryside of wildlife, wildlife will see the shine, will see your white skin or your coloured skin or whatever. So it will see your skin. So just cover that up. It's very, very simply done. So That's shine. Shape. So another bald head, but this just shows that you can see the pronounced shape of somebody, yeah, sitting down. How do we change that? By breaking that up. We've covered up the shine. We've covered up the shine. Our equipment is covered up. And we've sort of blended into the environment that we're working with. This was on the west coast of Scotland. And this is, many of you may have seen this kind of seaweed and bubble wrap, whatever it's called. But shape, just break up your shape. So you've got shine in your previous things. So wear a hat, cover your face up, cover your hands, and then be aware of your shape. Most animals in this country, apart from red deer, are at ground level. They see your shape, and I'll get onto the silhouette in a minute. So just break up your shape the best you can. You don't have to work like this, but just be aware of covering your head, your hands, and just break up your body shape. Wildlife won't be able to see the shape then. Silhouette is a massive thing. At dawn and dusk, when I work, those first 2 hours and those last 2 hours, you get a silhouette. Obviously, you can see some of that. Nate, wildlife sees that. But by getting down low, blending in, you're not having so much silhouette. So again, this is just the third key element within Fieldcraft, and that's silhouette. So on both of these, there's no shine, little bit of shine on my face, yeah. You've got rid of your shape there, the shape's there, and the silhouette. So silhouette and shape are kind of the same thing, but just be aware that this is what wildlife would see. And even though we can see this, and many subjects of wildlife have got better eyesights, they'd still see that, but you've made some effort with just breaking up your silhouette. I just wanted to give you some examples now of what this allowed me to do. This is in Shetland. This is the coast. And the tide came in and I was waiting for an otter most of the day. I've covered my shape, shine. You see little eyes, yeah, but nothing on my hands. I'm sitting low, so there's no silhouette. There's no prominent shape. And I'm just tucked in, very uncomfortably, but sitting on a little mat there, tucked in to blend in, waiting for the otter to come ashore. So by doing that, this was the picture that I was able to get. This is a male otter, dog otter, thick neck, quite big, beautiful, beautiful creatures. It came up right between these rocks, couldn't smell me, couldn't hear me, couldn't see me. So that was that previous picture, working with that mindset, with Fieldcraft, with the respect, with the awareness, shape, shine, silhouette. By eliminating those, I managed to get this encounter with this dog otter, which was beautiful. There's another example I wanted to show. This is in the Peak District. We've all had quite a bit of fog and mist at the minute. Again, I've broken up everything. There's a little bit of shape there, but I'm sort of moving through vegetation here. I've covered everything up, and this position allowed me to get the next picture whilst I was waiting. So I love red grouse. I think they're a beautiful moorland specialist, persecuted through sport. I'm going to try and keep it positive, but you'll see through OneKind's campaigns, people shoot these birds for fun, and they're absolutely beautiful. They have a lovely little call, blah, 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 blah. They communicate with you. And this is a male. You very rarely see the white legs, but this is just on the rock. So that picture previous, I got in position, covered everything up. I was aware, using Fieldcraft and respect. The sun broke free, as you can see. That's the valley below in the mist. And lo and behold, the male grouse just came up on these rocks. I couldn't have asked him to do any better, and he just stayed there. So this is just another example by just applying those key elements. So this is the last one. This might look a little bit over the top, but I was after foxes and their natural habitat, and foxes round bins, cheekily coming into your gardens. we see those. Yeah, I love foxes as well. In fact, I love all wildlife, but I really do love the British wildlife, and especially foxes and grouse and badgers, all the stuff that's persecuted, unfortunately. But going back to the picture, I've waited here for nearly 2 weeks. I did go home, it was not literally there, but just in this position. So I've taken care of my shape. I've taken care of my shine. There's no silhouette. That big thing is the lens hood, yeah, but it's covered. So I'm very, very aware. There's no wind. I've not used any smellies, deodorants or nothing. I'm just sitting there waiting because I've worked out here on the right is a little path that a fox uses. I learned that through smells and tracks. So by applying this again, so Fieldcraft, shape, shine, silhouette, very, very simple. You don't have to have my background. You don't have to be professional. It's just having an awareness by doing these things. Sometimes you get lucky. I had 3 shots of this male fox, which OneKind are using. He's got mange. Beautiful, wild encounter. 3 pictures and he was gone. It's a bluebell wood. It's an ancient wood I used to visit as a child. And there's a little walkway here that he used. I saw his tracks. Fox smell has a musty smell. I focused on the eye, composition really there is not looking into the frame, so that may confuse you, but that I was just given what I was given here. 3 shots, and that year I never saw him again. Don't know if he passed away, ran over. There's no hunting where this is, but sort of foxes living in an urban environment, returning back to their woodland, you know, they live a stressful life. But by just lying down and being very, very aware of what I was doing, it enabled me to get this. Tracks, it's a massive thing, tracks is. This is the path that fox used to walk. I'm using a fish eye here just to try and show you some contexture. So you'll see all this, to most people, it's just mud, some leaves. It's late winter, no coverage on the trees. If you look closer, fox, claw the badger, this is a little highway. So everybody will have this. You walk the dog, you see often dog tracks. Mistaking them for foxes, but once you see a dog pads, they're very, very easy to work out they're not. If the ground is wet, it's got moisture in, you can work out how old these tracks are. As soon as the sun starts to dry them, it lets you know there's an hour past, 2 hours. It lets you know if an animal's limping, like one of those pads might not be as pronounced. This pad here might be missing. So that means he's walking on 3 legs with the 4th one he's placing down. How will that affect me, Craig, taking pictures? Well, you can track something. You know, something's injured. You might come across it sooner than what you thought. It's just trying to think differently, that's all. You don't have to be Ray Mears or an ex-soldier. And I'm only saying that just to try and inspire people. I do lots and lots of talks for people, and I try and break down all the snobbery and all the techo stuff that sort of puts people off photography, and let them know the best camera is the person, and photography starts with the person. All that cameras and lenses and equipment does, it enables you to capture what's all around us. So tracks is really, really important. Put your wellies on, some old waterproof trousers, and go to a little wood or a little river or anywhere close by on an ordnance survey map, or use Google Earth. You'll find little places like this. Go for the first 2 hours, see things like this. Settle down, look for bits of fur against a tree as something scent marking, and I promise you, you'll get a very better understanding of what's here. And you can put a hide in, or you can come. I do photograph during the day, but as a photographer, if I'm working on a project, that first couple of hours and that last couple of hours can be very productive. Birds are singing before we get up. foxes are starting to call shortly because they go into the mating. You might hear the female screaming in the background, not here, but just shortly through December, January. That's the female saying she's on heat. All the clues are there, but just by pausing our lives and looking at this, just finally, tracks can be very, very important. These tracks here and this little highway learnt me about that male fox. I only got three pictures, but I'll remember that forever. Clothing is another really important part of fieldcraft. A decent hood, when you're out somewhere, you can pull that up. Deep pockets to put stuff in, and material. When you're buying something, rub your hands over it, rub it together. If it's making a real rustly sort of noise, forget it. I also do climbing, the Wainwrights, some of the Munros in Scotland, and the walking stuff that you walk in that's bright red and blue isn't right for wildlife photography or photographing, because it's one, very, very noisy. Two, it's bright and some animals will see that colour. So try and, if you specifically want some clothing for wildlife photography, often the best things, unfortunately, I shouldn't probably use this analogy, is hunting shops, because they sort of know what they're doing. But I don't go to hunting shops. This is Country Innovation. I'm sort of not sponsored by them, but I tested one of their coats. So I use this big pockets, big hood for when you're just sitting down there, a bit miserable. But rub it together. If it makes a real shh noise, forget it. If you're wanting to do wildlife photography, the red stuff, the blue stuff, Paramo, all that, Berghaus, fantastic, North Face. Yeah, I've got it all for walking. But when it comes to wildlife, dark muted clothing, big pockets, decent hood, and rub this material together. It's really, really important. It's one of the big things for fieldcraft. So I just wanted to show you a few pictures here. What I've got in a short minute, I take my headphones out, and I've just wanted to, it's an 8 minutes presentation going through all those four key elements: composition, light, settings, and fieldcraft. And you'll see some of these pictures. These mountain hares are photographed right high up in the Cairngorms National Park. This is really high up, so this is a glacier. And this is quite an unusual pose. So I just wanted to put this in, that this hare is relaxed, the ears there, little feet together, it's just cleaning, completely and utterly relaxed in my presence. All I've done is keep low, no movements, slowly moved when I had to move. I don't talk to animals like some people talk to, no. I respect animals on their terms, and it allows you to get close. Once you are happy, go back out the same way you came in and just leave that animal in peace. Now, this mountain hare was quite close to me. I took this picture and I crawled back. Know when enough's enough, and you'll be rewarded with beautiful moments like this. This hare is really comfortable. It's a beautiful, endearing picture. And I know what went into it that morning high up. I walked up in the dark. I got up to where the glacier is. You see all this is frozen. I took all my stuff off. I took all my rucksack, I mean. I crawled forward on my belly and I approached him over about 40 minutes. It took me slowly, slowly, slowly. Took me picture and I just slid back. So this is what you can do by just having that respect, fieldcraft, and using some of those key elements. So here I've used the light, you can see the light, but this is more about, you know, that respect element. That animal's respecting me, you can see it, it's not terrified. And when I'm photographing, I'm trying to document wild behavior, almost like a fly on the wall. I personally want privileged views. I want to be unnoticed, really, like a witness and a spectator. If it changes from that, you've got to really ask yourself, was it necessary? And am I affecting the situation? And is the animal in a panic before or after? Now, this animal isn't in a panic. But when you look at pictures on social media, you'll see animals making themselves look big, cuckoos, birds, threatening with their wings. You can see that they're in a state of panic before or after that picture was taken. If you look at the telltale signs a lot of people are taking pictures at the cost of wildlife. Now, I've not won any awards. I don't chase awards. I don't use that as an unconscious bias to say that I'm better than anybody. My award is this. And my point is that if you apply those key elements and you approach wildlife and it accepts you, that's the greatest award, absolute greatest award. And I photographed like this from those things that I learned as a child, that respect. Yes, I've employed some of the field craft that the British Army taught me, but I passed that on. The composition, again, here, like you'll see, looking into the frame, even though this is a male ptarmigan, again, photographed in the Cairngorms asleep. So I've created that space. So it's, you know, the composition, the light is, you know, bright. Fieldcraft is massive here. Look, that if any of you know about ptarmigan, they're very, very difficult to get near. And this one's asleep. So this isn't put in to make me look good. This is just to emphasize that you can get these unnoticed, privileged views of nature by just changing your own mindset. You really can. And like I said, I'm sorry to repeat, I put that background stuff in because I'm not only from that background, I'm sort of emphasizing that anybody can do this. This is a beautiful encounter, that was. I used a hide for this. So this is a red start. I love red starts. They come to a wood not far from the Peak District. So that, again, it's privileged views. The bird doesn't know you're there. Another fantastic migrant that arrives in our shores, spring, summer, pied flycatcher. If you go to my website and my blog and Google, you'll see lots of projects that I photograph these birds. He can't see me. He can hear something occasionally. This is in a hide. This isn't unnoticed, but the pied flycatcher is relaxed. It's going about its life. It's just looking. I love these birds. They're only black and white. I've got two spots there so the young can see them. If you do any Googling on these birds and work out they come from North Africa just to raise a family in some areas of being absolutely beautiful, them and red starts. So I'm using a hide here. The bird can see me, but I'm taking pictures on silence, slowly. Water voles are one of my favorite mammals. Their eyesight's really poor. They have some hearing. Sense of smell is amazing. They've got big hooters there, as you can see. This is feeding on the riverbank. Another, I'm documenting wild behavior. I've got a privileged view with respect. I'm a spectator. There's no panic before or after. Composition, it's a little bit tight, but I've still created that space by just simply moving the camera's viewfinder. I've watched. I'm low, so there's no silhouette. You can see I'm really low here, level with him. So just these things that will go through your mind, you know, those four key elements hopefully now may make a bit more sense. The composition, bang, straight away, subconscious. Silhouette, I'm low, I'm in the ground. Fieldcraft goes without saying, utmost respect for the animal. And the simple settings, wide open, so I can get the depth of field. You can see this stuff's blurred, because I've wanted that much depth of field. All this is blurred. That's because I've used F4, F5, 6, or F6.3 for those that have, you know, a Sigma lens or a Tamron lens or their aperture. So that depth of field, you can see that's sharp. That's all I want. This is blurred, blurred, blurred. And that's by using those wide open apertures. So instinctively, composition, I'm low. So there's no silhouette, depth of field. You start thinking and it becomes, I promise you, boom, 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 second nature, and you do it, so you do it without thinking. Seal pup photographed at 1,000 meters away with different converters, mother's behind, just looking up, composition, dead space, looking. Beautiful, beautiful moment. I was nowhere near to, you got to be careful with seals, but I just wanted to show you again. I'm not unnoticed here, but I'm documenting wild behavior. There's no panic before and after. The mother's there. Composition, I've got used to the light. You can see that I'm low. So subconsciously, again, I've gone through that checklist. Composition, bang. Silhouette, well, you know that I'm low, so I won't be creating a silhouette. I've used the light and I've used that depth of field on the eye. All this stuff is relatively blurred, and that's blurred. And this is the effect that you get by using aperture priority, or AV or A, and composing on the eye. And that's where the sharpness starts, and that's where it drops away. So what I've got now is a slideshow to show you all. I have to take out my mic for it to play. If nobody can hear the music, if somebody can sort of wave at me, but I did this talk recently, and by taking out my mic, you should be able to hear this. So here goes. And that's that.